Okay, we're going to start in about a minute.
Is this on?
Yeah. I see. Most of you know the routine, and that's good. If you want to speak, we ask that you fill out a blue speaker card. And feel free to fill one out and just walk up here and leave it here at the table. Yeah. And if we run out of blue cards, which we might, just you can leave a business card or a card or a piece of paper with your name on it, whatever works. Okay, so we have a lot of people here and a lot of interest, so we're going to start. Good morning. My name's Alan Hirsch. I am Chief Deputy Director of the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, and with me is our Chief Counsel, Carol Monahan Cummings. We'll just start out with a few housekeeping items. If you need to use the restrooms, they are out the door and to your left. You make two left turns, actually, and they will be there. In the unlikely event of an emergency, the best way out of the building is to go to the right, walk down the steps, and leave the front entrance of the building. This hearing is being webcast, so if you want to let a colleague know about that, they can go to the Cal EPA website, calepa.ca.gov, and click webcasts up at the top of the page. It's really small type, but if they look hard, they can find it. Under the provisions of the Administrative Procedure Act, this is the time and place set for the presentation of comments orally or in writing regarding the Proposition 65 warning regulation that is proposed for adoption by the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment. OEHHA considers this proceeding to be a quasi-legislative hearing because it is carrying out a rulemaking function delegated to it by the state. OEHHA will take under submission all written comments and oral statements submitted or made during this hearing. The director of OEHHA has designated me to conduct this hearing on his behalf, and I will be doing so in accordance with provisions of the Administrative Procedure Act. The entire proceeding is being recorded by a certified court reporter who is here to my right. The transcript and all exhibits and evidence presented at this hearing will be included in the administrative record for this rulemaking. The written public comment period for the proposed rulemaking will close on April 8, 2015. For organizational purposes, we request that those of you wishing to speak at this hearing complete a blue speaker's card. There are hopefully some left in the back of the room, and we already have a number here. If we run out of speaker's cards, you can use a business card or write your name on a piece of paper, whatever works. And you can just leave it up here at the table, although you are not required to do so in order to speak. Also, I want to be sure you're aware that because this is a formal public hearing, we will essentially be in listening mode. Many of you may have either attended or watched the informal pre-regulatory workshops that we've held on our Prop 65 warnings, where we engaged in back and forth conversations with many of you. But formal public hearings such as this one are not really set up for those kinds of back and forth talks. So in this case, we may be able to answer some very basic clarifying questions if you have any, or we may ask very simple clarifying questions of commenters. But if we do adopt a final regulation, we will have written responses to the comments that we receive at today's hearing, as well as the written comments, of course, that we get during the written comment period. if you have a very detailed comment, we strongly recommend that you submit it to us in writing by the April 8th deadline. And I do want to emphasize that because we do have a lot of people here and a lot of people who wish to speak. I'm going to ask that you try to keep your comments to about 5 minutes in length. And of course, again, if you have more detailed things that you want to say, by all means, make sure that those are in writing and submit them to us by the written comment deadline, April 8th. So I also want to clarify, there's been a little bit of confusion that this public hearing now is on our proposed warning regulation. We have a public hearing on our companion regulation on the Proposition 65 website. That will take place at 1:30 p.m. today in this same room. So we understand that the two regulations are definitely connected. So if you have big picture comments about the whole package, certainly I don't think you have to be concerned about mentioning the website reg. But if you have specific comments about it, we would really ask, if at all possible, that you come back at 1:30. That would be the time to make comments on the website reg. So to enable the audience to hear you and to ensure that your comments are recorded for the record, you would come to the microphone on my left when you are called to speak. And it's helpful to the court reporter if you state your name and the organization that you represent, if any. However, you're not required to do so in order to speak. So at this time, Ms. Bonahan Cummings will give a short presentation on our proposed warning regulation.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Hirsch. Before I start the presentation on the regulation, I wanted to say that in order to save time required to read into the record each provision of the proposed regulation, which you all would really not want me to do. I have presented to the court reporter a copy of the text of the proposed regulation together with the public notice and the initial statement of reasons in order to have them included in the hearing record. As required by the Administrative Procedure Act, the public and interested parties were notified of these proposed regulations 45 days, actually more than 45 days prior to today's hearing. The notice of this proposed regulation was published in the CRNR on OEHHA's website and sent by email to interested groups and individuals on January the 16th, 2015. Would the court reporter please mark the exhibit as OEHHA's Exhibit A? Thank you. Okay, so as Alan mentioned, this morning we're talking about our proposed changes to the current safe harbor warnings for Prop 65. And this afternoon, Mr. Fernandez will be going over the changes or the new regulation for our warning website. Next slide. So the purpose of any regulations on this subject is to make specific some of the terminology that's in the statute. The statute requires businesses who knowingly and intentionally expose any individual to a chemical known to the state to cause cancer or reproductive toxicity to give a warning prior to that exposure. So, and the warning needs to be clear and reasonable. Knowing, intentional, expose, clear, and reasonable are not defined in the statute. So, next slide. What we're, our current regulation and the proposed regulation are intended to explain what some of these terms mean. The existing regulation was adopted many, many years ago in 1988. Well prior to the advent of the internet and smartphones and various other communication methods. And so one of our goals here is to kind of bring this regulation into the 21st century. by adopting some procedures and methods of providing warnings that weren't available when the regulation was first adopted. As many of you know, we've already conducted pre-regulatory workshops in July of 2013, April of 2014, and in September of 2014, we also circulated a pre-regulatory draft of the regulation for further comments from interested stakeholders. We carefully looked at the comments that we had received all the way through the process, and we met with numerous stakeholder groups numerous times for some of them, and really worked hard to try and make sure that we understood the issues that people have about their own businesses and their own types of exposure issues and ways to address those, and we made every effort to try and include those in our proposed regulation to the extent they are consistent with the law. Next slide. So our timeline for this particular regulation now, we're not in the pre-regulatory stage anymore. This is an actual regulatory process. That's why we're having a hearing rather than a workshop. So the timeline is that we posted our proposed regulation in January on our website, and it's still available there. We're having a public hearing today. And as Alan mentioned, the comment period closes on April the 8th. Our final deadline to adopt the regulation is January 2016, so we have a few months before we need to final the regulation, and we do anticipate at least one more round of changes and public comments before we proceed to adopt the regulation. Next slide. So our proposed regulation, what we would actually be doing is a full repeal of the existing regulation and an adoption of a brand new regulation. The reason for that is if you review the proposal, it changes the current regulation so much that it would be virtually impossible to follow it in underlying strikeout mode. And so we decided to just do a full repeal. That does not mean that none of the provisions of the prior regulation are being retained. There's actually quite a lot of the existing regulation that's retained in the new proposal. One of the main things that is being retained, although in one of our earlier versions it wasn't, is the safe harbor concept for the warnings. And what safe harbor means essentially is that if a business uses the methods and content that we set out in our regulation, they have a safe harbor from enforcement for those kinds of exposures from that product or area. So that means that we're giving compliance assistance to businesses and also guidance to enforcement in regard to what a clear and reasonable warning is. But the businesses still retain the flexibility in our regulation to provide a warning using any method or any content they choose, but they would not have a safe harbor protection for that. They would just need to prove that it is, in fact, clear and reasonable. Throughout this process, as I mentioned, we've been working with business groups and others to try and develop tailored warnings for specific kinds of product or area exposures. For example, one that we have retained from the prior regulation with some modifications is for exposures to chemicals in alcoholic beverages. We've developed one for dental care exposures, furniture exposures, diesel engines, automobiles, that sort of thing. I think we have at least a dozen proposed specialized warnings for different circumstances. Next slide. Oh, and I should mention that those that we have in the regulation, the specialized warnings, we're very open to adopting additional ones to the extent that they would have general enough application to where it makes sense to have them in a regulation. And so any of our stakeholder groups, and some of them have already come to us saying we want to talk to you about adopting a particular warning process or content, especially ones that are already being used, sometimes based on litigation that is passed. And we're happy to consider those and adopting them in our regulation if it makes sense. Okay, so one of the main changes that we have in this regulation, this proposed regulation versus the current one, is that the current regulations requires or allows a business to say that a product contains a chemical or an area contains a chemical. And our position is that the statute itself talks about exposures, not contents of areas, and so we would be modifying the safe harbor to require that people say that in fact the product can expose you to, or the area can't, you can be exposed to a particular chemical in an area. So we think that would be more consistent with the statute. It also makes more clear that the warnings are really not required for content. They're required for exposure, and just because a chemical might be present somewhere in a product doesn't mean that it's available to expose someone to that chemical, and so we are hoping to reduce some of the unnecessary warnings that are being given now. We believe that our proposed warnings, the content is going to be more informative. And as I mentioned, we are hoping that content will reduce the overwarning issues that we have in California. Next slide. So this gives you an example of the difference between the two, the current regulation safe harbor language and the proposed regulation safe harbor. The one on the top is kind of your classic warning that you see on lots of products. It says the product contains chemicals known to the state to cause cancer. We get thousands of phone calls every year, emails, phone calls, you know, other kinds of inquiries about that warning. It has become clear to us it isn't clear and reasonable because people don't know whether they're being exposed, how they're being exposed, what chemical they might be being exposed to. And they have no route for actually getting additional information. In many cases, what we normally do is refer the person back to whoever's providing the warning, and our feedback from the people that try that is that they send them back to us and say, OEHHA requires us to provide this warning. We don't know why. Talk to them, and we don't know why either. And so there's an infinite loop there, and people are not getting the information that the law actually contemplates. So if you look at the bottom part of this slide, you can see we have decided to incorporate a symbol. Most people in the current culture are used to symbols. They have a tendency not to want to read so much as they want to see a symbol and know what that means. It also helps with non-English speaking populations. And it's a fairly universal symbol that's being used in many different circumstances, including by certain regulatory groups like ANSI. And if you happen to have Microsoft products on your computer, you see these little symbols all the time. So we're using a symbol that using the word warning, which is required before, although we're asking for it to be in bold. And then the language is different in the sense that we're saying this product can expose you to, and in this particular example, we're including the word formaldehyde because, as I'll mention later, certain chemicals have to be identified in the warning. And the usual language about it's known to cause cancer. We're adding a reference to the URL to the OEHHA website for additional information. And we are hoping that we'll be able to provide much more information to the public than they are receiving now about what that chemical might, what it is, what kinds of effects it can have, how the person might be being exposed, whether they're breathing it, they're ingesting it, they may be touching something that has it in it, and they could be exposed through hand to mouth. They may have dermal exposure. And a lot of that information is available publicly, and we would just be pulling that together on our website. Next slide. So as I mentioned, there are some chemicals that OEHHA has determined should be actually named in the warning. Those of you who have attended our pre-regulatory workshops or other types of meetings are aware that there are a number of stakeholders that believe that a warning isn't clear if it doesn't actually name the chemical that's being that the warning is being provided for, and have stated strongly in many different formats that the warnings should include the names of all chemicals that it's intended to cover. Given that the current list of chemicals under Prop 65 has more than 800 individual chemicals on it, we were kind of reticent to make that requirement, and there are products that have some pretty a long list of chemicals that could cause exposures, and some of the names of those chemicals can be pretty daunting. So what we determined is that there are situations where it's appropriate and possible to provide the names of chemicals in the warning. And so this list of chemicals you see up here, right now we have 12. Some of our earlier drafts had many more than that. But we have included in our statement of reasons the criteria we use to select these chemicals, including the fact that there's a fair amount of enforcement activity around those exposures. Some of the chemicals are very common in cause exposures frequently. A lot of them are chemicals that that we're very concerned about. And so if you look in the statement of reasons for the regulation, you can get background on each chemical and the basically five criteria that we use to select those. I should mention that this part of our regulation is being peer reviewed by our CIC and DART members. Those are our state's qualified experts for Prop 65. They are peer reviewing that information, and their peer review comments will be included in the record, and we'll consider those as we proceed with the regulation. Next slide. So for many, many years, actually since the law was passed, there's been this provision that people have had questions about, and that is there's a provision in the law that says to the extent feasible or reasonable, product manufacturers should be required to provide the warning themselves or provide the warning materials so that the burden of providing that information doesn't rest on the retailers. And so one of the provisions that we have included in the regulation, and I should mention that when you look at the regulation, there's two sections. It's got two articles, subarticle one and a subarticle two. And subarticle one is a mandatory section. Subarticle two is safe harbor. So in the subarticle one, we have kind of general provisions, we have definitions, and we have this provision about the responsibility, relative responsibility between product manufacturers and others in the chain of commerce versus retailers of consumer, mostly consumer products, but it can include any other products that are covered by the law. So we've had a lot of requests for explanation of how those requirements in the statute should apply in the real world. And so we have included this provision that allows gives more clarity about who in that chain is required to provide the information, how they might do that. One of the provisions, you know, if you start with manufacturers or producers, they can provide the warning, say, on the product, and that warning is going to follow through all the way to a retailer. Sorry, which one should we be on here? Oh, I'm sorry, next slide. There you have it. Thank you. Okay, so what we're trying to do, though, is make it clear that where a manufacturer, producer, packager chooses to put a warning on the package, as long as the other businesses in the chain don't remove it, deface it, hide it, then that warning is going to be sufficient at the point of retail sale. Now, on the other hand, if the manufacturer or producer does not put the warning on the product, then there's a process that's set out in this regulation for who needs to provide what information to the next people in line. At the point of sale, where the retailer is ultimately on the hook to provide a warning, there we did include a very narrow exception for retailers in terms of knowledge of an exposure that requires a warning, and provides an opportunity for the retailer to either pull the product off the shelf till they have time to contact the manufacturer or the producers, whoever sold it to them, or provide the warning that's required under the Act. We've got a definition here of what actual knowledge means as it relates to retail sales. And so I would suggest strongly that anyone who is in the chain of manufacture of a product that requires a warning, review this carefully and let us know if you have concerns about it or there's further clarification that's needed. One of the other provisions that we have that's new in our regulation is that when a foreign language is used on the product or in packaging for the product, that the warning is also provided in that language. If you think about how diverse the population in California is now, English is not the primary language anymore, and so there's a lot of communications that happen in other languages, and so we're trying to make sure that in order for the warning to actually be clear and reasonable to the person that's receiving it, there may be a need to translate the warnings to actually reach those audiences. There is a possibility, by the way, I know there's some questions that have come up on this, that we would have translated versions of the most common warnings available on our website, probably not in every possible language, but in the main ones like Spanish and some of the other most common languages a warning might be provided in. Next slide. So, just as a summary, some of the other provisions that we have in the regulation that may be of interest to you is that we are including the URL for the OEHHA website in all warnings. And we'll talk about the website more this afternoon, but the purpose of that is to provide additional information to the public that we're aware that the warnings can't be 3 pages long for, you know, a product that's this big. Or even if it's a bigger product, nobody wants to read 3 pages. And so we're hoping that the information we'll have on our website is going to be user-friendly enough. There'll be fact sheets and things like that for the public so that they know what the chemical is and how they might be being exposed, and information that is, like I said, a little bit too much to put on the warning itself. Our current version of the warning has a delayed effective date of 2 years. That's effectively a sell-through period or a period to allow businesses to start implementing the law. During that two-year period, businesses are able to use either the old safe harbor that's currently in the regulation or the new one, and we would certainly be encouraging people to move towards the new one as soon as it's adopted if they want to maintain the safe harbor. So it does give 2 years before the old safe harbor language is no longer considered a safe harbor. Having said that, that doesn't mean that the old safe harbor isn't a clear and reasonable warning. That would be something that would be up for discussion if a business received a 60-day notice. They could certainly argue it was still clear and reasonable. In a couple of our earlier drafts, we had a specific provision saying that we were grandfathering in court-approved warning methods and content. We decided not to have that in there because it was just a restatement of existing law. There was no reason to put it in our regulation because it's true anyway, and we can't tell the court to change their orders. And so the court-approved warnings and methods are certainly still valid. They are binding on the parties to those agreements or judgments. However, one thing that we would point out is that, as I mentioned, we're open to adopting additional regulations that are specific to products or areas or types of exposures. And if someone has a court-approved warning or method that they would like us to adopt more generally in our regulations, we're happy to look at that. And that really goes with the last bullet here about we have specifically pointed out that any stakeholder can petition us to adopt a tailored warning, whether it's based on a court-approved warning or not. If it's one that you're already using, or it's an adaptation of something that you need for another program. Maybe the Air Resources Board requires something, and we might be able to just kind of tweak that and make it fit, that sort of thing. So we're very open to talking to anyone about that. Next slide. So you'll notice on here that this is not my name. And that's intentional. Mario Fernandez is sitting up here with the red tie. Mario is the lead on this regulation as well as the website regulation, and much easier to reach than I am. And so his information is up here, and I encourage you to work with him, particularly on language changes, more technical issues that you'd like to see addressed in the regulation. You can also reach me. I've got my cards up here. Any general questions before we get comments? Yeah, do you go the one before? Go back. Do you want to go ahead and come up? Maybe you can go ahead and come up. Yeah, it's just easier for the court reporter and for the people on the web.
Hi, I'm Steve Myroney with the American Coons Association. On this third to last slide, you skipped over this. You said a compliant OSHA cowl. Sorry, on the third point, you said a compliant OSHA label or cowl OSHA warning suffices for Prop 65. I just want to clarify that that's for occupational exposure, not for on-product warnings, correct?
That's correct. And federal OSHA and Cal OSHA regulations only apply to occupational exposures of individuals to chemicals. And so what our regulation says, and actually it's consistent with our current regulation, is that if in an occupational setting, you're complying with both federal and Cal OSHA warning requirements, including training and whatever else they're requiring, then a separate warning under Prop 65 is not required. That could apply to a product that isn't sold or used by another individual outside the occupational setting.
Yeah, I think it's very clear in the regs, and I agree. I just think that sentence on the slide is very misleading, and you sent them out pretty widely, and I just want to make sure that's clear to people that read that's not exactly what that says.
So. Right, so you've got to look at the reg and the statement of reasons. Thank you.
Okay, so now we'll begin the public comments. Again, we have a number of speakers, so we ask that you try to limit your comments to 5 minutes, and most of the speakers have indicated that's about all they need, which is good. I'm reluctant to cut anyone off if they go significantly more than 5 minutes, but I'll reserve my right to do it if I have to. And also, if you came in late and didn't hear, if you want to speak, please fill out we ask that you fill out a blue speaker's card, and if there aren't any, you can leave a business card, but you can bring the speaker card or your business card up here, and we'll add it to the list. So the first speaker is Tammy Wall of the American Herbal Products Association.
Good morning. Thank you for the time today. My name is Tammy Wall, Special Regulatory Counsel for the American Herbal Products Association. We are a national trade organization based in the DC metro area and serve our members by promoting the responsible commerce of herbal products. APA is comprised of domestic and foreign companies doing business as growers, processors, manufacturers, and marketers of herbs and herbal products. Many of our members conduct business in the great state of California and thus are subject to this regulation, therefore here I am. So there are 2 points that I'll address today. The first being, we noted in the proposed amendment that the definition of food includes dietary supplements. This provides tremendous clarification, and we thank you for the consideration of this. By ensuring that the naturally occurring exemption is available to supplement products, and in light of the various state and federal regulatory frameworks for supplements, this also definitively states which class of product dietary supplements belong to for purposes of Prop 65. The second matter, it's a recommendation to include an optional warning for food exposures to reproductive toxins, an optional warning that would articulate which specific population would be impacted by the exposure. For example, if female reproductive toxicity is the concern with a listed chemical, then specify in the warning which implicated population. For example, not for use by women who are pregnant or trying to conceive. Men who are trying to conceive or infants or children are three other populations that could be identified. We are not requesting to remove or amend the proposed warnings under 25608.2, only to include an additional optional warning. Directing the warning to a targeted demographic versus an open-ended warning that may not apply to all individuals is more meaningful and more informative for the consumer. This warning will lead to greater compliance by both industry and consumers due to a better understanding of the applicability of the warning. Our proposal fits squarely within the charge from Governor Brown to improve how the public is warned, is in direct alignment with your agency's explicit intention to provide more useful and informative warnings, and wholly satisfies the requirement under the Act of a clear and reasonable warning. We are simply proposing a tailored warning that provides the consumer with a more instructive warning to further this right to know law, an optional tailored warning that will absolutely provide greater clarification for the consumer. Written comments will be forthcoming, and of course, we are available to discuss at your convenience. Thank you again for the time.
Thank you very much. Next speaker would be Michelle Endo from the Center for Environmental Health.
Thank you for the opportunity to comment on OEHHA's proposed Proposition 65 warning regulations. We very much support OEHHA's goals to provide more useful information to Californians about their exposure to listed chemicals and to provide more compliance to citizens for effective businesses. We believe the proposed regulations accomplish these goals, and we support their adoption with some important changes that we will discuss shortly. First, I want to thank OEHHA for their proposals to ensure that the warnings are provided in appropriate languages. In light of the diversity of California's population, we particularly support the requirement to provide warnings in languages other than English. Next, some important changes. One, during the process of drafting the proposed regulations, OEHHA changed the basic language of the safe harbor warning to will expose to can expose. This change makes the warning significantly more ambiguous and does not meet the clear standard of the statute. Two, the current proposal removes the responsibility of most retailers to provide clear and reasonable warnings. We believe this is not consistent with the statute. The statute states, in order to minimize the burden on retail sellers of consumer products, including foods, regulations, implementing section 25249.6 shall, to the extent practicable, place the obligation to provide any warning material, such as labels, on the producer or packager rather than the retail seller. The current proposal goes much farther than the statutory requirement. These provisions are likely to create confusion, lead to further litigation, and ultimately undermine rather than further the purposes of the statute. In today's global economy, when producers and packagers of most consumer products are outside of the U.S., it is crucial that retailers do their part to provide information that consumers need and which Proposition 65 guarantees. Three, we strongly support the name and the namings of relevant chemicals in Proposition 65 safe harbor warnings. This will further Proposition 65's right to know purpose by providing more meaningful information to consumers who are seeking, for instance, to avoid cumulative exposure to particular chemicals or to educate themselves more about their choices. Product labels are the most important place for the chemical name information to be included, since labels are most likely to be read by consumers, and because consumers can bring product labels into their home and to their care professionals for advice. The on-product label exception should be eliminated. In addition, a method should be provided for adding chemicals in the list in subsection A, since other chemicals, either ones currently listed under Proposition 65 or newly listed chemicals, may be appropriate to name in a warning due to their widespread use, toxicity, or for other reasons. The current proposal allows warnings to be provided during the purchase of the product. This is not a reasonable method for providing warnings as required by the statute. To avoid an exposure, consumers should not have to go through a checkout line twice or to repeat often cumbersome online purchase procedures. In addition, the proposal provides that warnings about the internet purchases can be provided by a hyperlink. This is not consistent with the requirement that warnings be clear and reasonable, because too many consumers will miss the hyperlink or will be confused by its relevance or applicability. Thank you again for this opportunity, and we strongly support OEHA's goals and general direction with this proposal.
Great, thank you. Okay, next speaker, and may not get this pronunciation right, Javine Komaram of the American Coatings Association.
Hi. Good morning, and thank you for holding this hearing today regarding your proposed amendments to Article 6, Clear and Reasonable Warning Regulations in Prop 65. My name is Javine Nakumaram, and I'm with the American Coatings Association, or ACA. We're a national trade association representing the paint and the coatings industry. As an association with many member companies that are affected by Prop 65, we appreciate the opportunity to comment and be involved in this rulemaking process as we have been for the past couple of years. It's worth noting that ACA appreciates the many improvements that OEHHA has made to this proposal since its initial draft release last year. We see this proposal as a step in the right direction, particularly the change with the will expose to the can expose language. However, we would also like to speak to a number of practical concerns we still have with the current proposal and offer suggestions that are consistent with the agency's goal of reducing frivolous litigation. We appreciate the time OEHHA took yesterday to talk to us about many of our issues, but we just wanted to reiterate a couple of our main concerns for the record. The first is the proposal's lack of a sell-through period. The second is the 12 chemicals required to be listed on the warnings, and the font and color requirements for product warnings. First, concerning the sell-through period, Section 25600 states that this article will become effective 2 years after the date of adoption. OEHHA should also allow for a sell-through period to ensure that labeled products that are already in the distribution chain before the two-year period will remain compliant and not be targets for potential litigation. Particularly for our industry, a sell-through period is important because paint has a long shelf life. The shelf life of formulated products ranges between sometimes 6 months or sometimes 2 years, sometimes even longer. Formulators ship products to thousands of distributors throughout the country, and these distributors often ship the product through additional distributors prior to the product arriving at the retail point of sale. So due to the complex supply chain and the lengthy shelf life, industry needs an unlimited sell-through period, which would allow all products manufactured prior to the ultimate compliance date to remain in commerce. Without this unlimited sell-through period, it's likely that a large quantity of formulated products already in the distribution chain will need to be relabeled or destroyed in order to prevent potential litigation. We believe this suggestion will go a long way in particularly protecting small businesses from potential litigation, and it would not impose any danger to the public since these products will already have warnings on them. Second, we continue to have concerns with the chemical-specific labeling requirements. Section 25602 lists the 12 chemicals that would be required to be included on warnings. ACA, we've argued in the last round of comments, and we will continue to do so. We believe that this chemical-specific labeling approach will only further confuse consumers and leave regulated entities even more vulnerable to potential litigation. Significantly, OEHHA has not provided a science-based selection criteria for selecting these particular 12 chemicals and is largely basing criteria on unquantifiable factors such as widespread prevalence or recognizability to the public. Merely identifying a chemical on a label does not provide the consumer with the appropriate context necessarily. Rather, mandating chemical-specific labels for these chemicals may mislead the public to perceive that they're more dangerous than other chemicals or, in effect, prioritizing them. Overall, the ACA does not support the chemical-specific labeling approach. However, if OEHHA plans to keep this part of the regulation, we urge OEHHA to enumerate the criteria you use in selecting these chemicals in the regulatory text rather than just the initial statement of reason. That way, affected parties will be able to predict if any other chemicals are added in the future and kind of see what's coming down the line. And then finally, the font and color requirements on the product warnings. Section 25604 requires that the content for product exposure warnings include the yellow ANSI symbol in the word warning in all caps. The proposal states that if the signage for labeling on the product is not in color, then the ANSI symbol can be black and white, otherwise the yellow is required. Many of our members' companies are subject to the Federal Hazard Communication Standard, which requires labels with pictograms to be in red and black. This creates a problem since they would not be afforded the black and white color option under this proposal, and they would have to put the Prop 65 pictogram in with the yellow and black. Many industry product manufacturers have purchased two-tone printers to comply with the 2012 HAZCOM standard. So requiring an additional color of yellow would require these manufacturers to purchase new printers, and that could cost many companies, that cost them a lot of money, sometimes up to $10,000, $10,000 per unit. So we suggest that OEHHA allow manufacturers using the GHS pictograms, again, that have the red on them, to be afforded this black and white option. This is just a technical suggestion that would not deter from warning consumers, and it could save potentially thousands of dollars for affected companies. And as for the font, rather than requiring the labels to have a specific 8-point font, we recommend OEHHA adopt a more flexible approach to accommodate smaller container sizes, such as the font having to be, quote, no smaller than other warnings you have to provide, or consider the font requirements enumerated in the Federal Hazardous Substances Act, which have, they already have a system to compute font size based on the size of labels. So again, we'll address our other concerns in our written comments, but we thank you again for the opportunity to speak now.
Thank you very much. Okay, next speaker, and I might not get this pronunciation right either, Ismail Pekvoza Jr., Trojan Battery.
Good morning. My name is Ismail Pedroza, Director of Environmental Health and Safety Affairs at Trojan Battery in Santa Fe Springs, California. Today, I'm here on behalf of Battery Cancer International, commonly referred to as BCI. BCI is a nonprofit trade association whose members are engaged in manufacture, distribution, sales, and recycling of lead-acid batteries, products subject to Proposition 65. BCI members account for over 98% of the U.S. lead battery production and over 97% of its recycling secondary lead smelting capacity. BCI members operate manufacturing and secondary lead smelting facilities in California and employ several thousand California workers. BCI appreciates the opportunity to provide input on the California Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment proposed modification to Proposition 65 implementing regulation. All BCI members lead acid battery manufacturers today include Proposition 65 complaint warnings on batteries sold in California and other states. The large majority of the U.S. lead acid battery manufacturers are parties to a settlement of a 1999 lawsuit brought by the Mattie Environmental Justice Foundation. It adopted lead acid battery specific language for our product warnings. The language reads, battery posts, terminals, and related accessories contain lead and lead compound chemicals known to the state of California to cause cancer and reproductive harm. Wash hands after handling. That language is still in use today, but BCI is concerned that the current proposed revision to the regulation will unnecessarily create confusion regarding the continued applicability of this language and wording sanctioned in other court-approved settlements entered in under the prior regulation. BCI agrees with OEHHA's statement in the initial statement of reason that, quote, businesses who are parties to a settlement or judgment must comply with the provisions of the court order regardless whether this regulation states the fact, end quote. But that is not end of the matter. Companies abiding by court-approved language might today be viewed by OEHHA or the public to not be in compliance with the new regulation, even if that view is incorrect. They could even be forced to defend new private enforcement lawsuits. They must be avoided. This must be avoided. Absence a clear grandfather clause, there is likely to be significant confusion among industry, the public, and private enforcement litigants, and your rules should expressly preclude any such confusion. Ours is not an unjustified concern. In most instances, it is very likely that members of the public are not aware of any existence or content of any particular court-approved settlement. While the California Attorney General publishes annual list of the settlements of which it is notified, there is no public database of the contents of those settlements, and the Attorney General's office only retains copies of the limited number for years. This makes it difficult for members of the public to become informed about court-approved warning statements. Thus, persons comparing the language on a product subject to the court-approved settlement with the new regulation safe harbor language could notice significant differences. This might, understandably, lead some to incorrectly believe those products to not be in compliance with Proposition 65. Therefore, it is entirely foreseeable that duplicative and unnecessary private litigations will be pursued based on a misunderstanding of the court-approved warning language's compliance with the new regulation. Only for the defendant to respond by pointing to the historical court-approved settlement. Even if a limited response proves significant to resolve the dispute, court filings require legal assistance and impose otherwise avoidable costs and burdens on the plaintiff, defendants, and the courts. Furthermore, while BCI and OEHA understand that the parties to a settlement must continue to comply with the settlement, absence an explicit grandfather exemption in the new rule, it may be unclear to a court whether those parties would in fact be legally exempt from the new safe harbor language. A private litigant may choose to assert the old settlement is no longer sufficient despite OEHA's informal and non-binding assurance that it is. Defendants could be forced to prove to a new court that the prior court-approved settlement is binding and that it still meets requirements of the regulation, essentially relitigating the earlier case for no good reason and at great cost. On the other hand, its clear and ambiguous grandfather clause would provide a clear means of unnecessary defendants to show and that existing court-approved settlements are still compliant with Prop 65, thus alleviating these concerns. While such a clause may not preclude lawsuits from an unaware or uninformed private litigant, it would clearly indicate to any court that there is no need to relitigate the prior court-approved settlement and would allow the prompt and swift disposition of those lawsuits. BCI also believes that OEHA should include a streamlined process of a non-parties to a court-approved settlement to obtain OEHA's approval for them to use the same language, particularly once the updated regulations come into force. In industries such as BCI's, where various companies sell similar-looking products, it may create confusion among consumers for otherwise awarding similar products to carry significant difference Prop 65 warnings. The goal of Proposition 65 is to inform consumers, not to confuse them. OEHA currently proposal to require non-parties to resort to a request for rulemaking under Government Code Section 11340.6 is unnecessarily burdensome on both industry and OEHA. Small businesses should not be required to pursue a full rulemaking petition for the relatively simple proposal of adopting already a court-approved language. Furthermore, if non-parties to a significant number of court-approved settlements seek OEHA's action to approve their use of that language, OEHA could be faced with the overwhelming resource demands to process, evaluate, solicit comments, and go through formal rulemaking on each of those requests. Instead, OEHA should adopt a more streamlined process by which non-parties can receive direct approval from the agency to use language already approved by a court. BCI thanks you for your time and attention to our concerns. If you have any questions about these comments, please contact David Weinberg, BCI's legal counsel, at 202-719-7102 or at dweinberg@wileyryan.com.
Okay, thank you very much. Next speaker will be Stephen Brown, California Dental Association.
Good morning. Stephen Brown on behalf of the California Dental Association. Thank you for this opportunity to stakeholders to offer input on the effort to update Proposition 65's clear and reasonable warning regulations. Representing approximately 25,000 licensed dentists in California, the California Dental Association is pleased with the language that is provided in the dental care exposure warning sections of the most recent legislative package. The California Dental Association supports the continuation of the safe harbor that is applied to dental offices, as well as the exposure-specific warnings that have been included in the draft warning notice. We appreciate the efforts of OEHA staff to assist with reasonable implementation of the updated warning notice. Given the number of dentists in California, providing a 2-year delayed implementation date allows adequate time for CDA to educate its members on the new regulation and ensure compliance. Finally, CDA supports the lead agency website so long as the process enables professional organizations like CDA to provide relevant chemical and exposure information for the website on behalf of its members. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you CDA's position on this important regulatory process.
Thank you. Next speaker is Elizabeth Trainer, Fillmar Regulatory Roundtable. Okay, I'll put her back in the queue here. So then the next speaker would be Anthony Sampson, California Chamber of Commerce.
Good morning, Anthony Sampson with the California Chamber of Commerce. I'd like to first thank Carol, Alan, Mario, Gina, I see you back there, you can't hide, meeting with us on several occasions over the past, I guess it's been a year and a half now or so. You've taken my phone calls, we've sat on panels together, and you certainly cannot be accused of not responding to the business community in terms of wanting to sit down and meet about this issue. Notwithstanding the open communication, however, in reviewing this January draft, it's still extraordinarily problematic. And I intend to speak more broadly with the understanding that you'll be receiving a comment letter from the California Chamber of Commerce and its coalition in the next week or two. So in reading the initial statement of reasons from front to back, it gives the impression that the proposal would be an extraordinary benefit to the business community. And I'll give you a few examples. First, on page 41 of the initial statement of reasons, it states that compliance with the regulations will essentially be relatively simple because the proposal provides, quote, minimum elements and thus sets a floor for what constitutes a clear and reasonable warning. Second, on page 41, the ISOR states that litigation concerning the adequacy of warnings will be reduced. And third, the ISOR on page 42 states that if adopted, the proposed regulations will have no economic impact whatsoever because the proposed regulation creates a voluntary program and thus imposes no new requirements on California business. I respectfully disagree with all three of these statements. From a compliance perspective, the whole regulatory package, according to OEHHA, is intended to only provide non-mandatory and voluntary guidance for what the methods and content, guidance for the methods and content of Proposition 65 warnings, leaving businesses free to warn using any means they wish, as long as the warnings are clear and reasonable and they can defend it as such. On the other hand, the ISOR then states that the proposed regulations provide, quote, more specificity regarding the minimum elements for providing clear and reasonable warnings for exposure. And I emphasize the term minimum elements. These dual and conflicting goals are ambiguous and confusing, and they establish fertile ground for litigation regarding whether warnings not utilizing the safe harbor text or methods of transmission are in fact clear and reasonable within the meaning of the statute. The regulated community simply cannot be asked to shoulder the burdens of OEHHA's lack of clarity on this critical point. From a litigation perspective, OEHHA has repeatedly stated that it does not want to further exacerbate the already problematic Proposition 65 litigation climate, and that's obviously something we very much support. To this end, OEHHA, however, without any substantiation, concludes that litigation concerning the adequacy of warnings should also be reduced as a result of increased clarity provided by the proposed changes to the regulations. OEHHA's conclusion is not supported, nor can it be. As a threshold matter, litigation or threatened litigation concerning the content of provided warnings is extremely rare under today's climate. The vast majority of litigation or threatened litigation instead challenges a business's decision to not provide a warning. The proposed regulation, however, opens up an entirely new frontier of bad warning enforcement actions by, for example, requiring warnings to specify one or more of 12 specific chemicals, requiring warnings to be translated into foreign language if any other labeling or sign about the product is provided in that language, and three, the requirement that any supplemental information shall not dilute or diminish the warning without any definition of what that even means. This component of the proposal is specifically that it will create multiple new avenues for litigation regarding the adequacy of warnings that do not exist today is particularly troubling because it blatantly disregards the Chamber and Coalition's previously stated concerns to this effect, but perhaps more importantly, it completely disregards the Governor's calls to end frivolous shakedown lawsuits as articulated in May of 2013. From an economic perspective, OEHHA summarily concludes that the proposal will have absolutely no financial impact on California businesses. OEHHA reaches this conclusion based on the erroneous view that the proposal, and I quote, does not impose any new requirements upon private persons or business because it primarily provides non-mandatory guidance and a voluntary safe harbor process for providing warnings already required under the Act that businesses can choose to follow. Once again, OEHHA's failure to articulate whether the, quote, minimum elements it references concern its proposed new safe harbor, or more broadly, the statutory warning requirement itself will lead to some to conclude that all businesses must replace their existing Proposition 65 warnings, not just be prepared to defend them. But even if this fundamental problem is addressed in a final rule, OEHHA's economic analysis is still inadequate because it incorrectly assumes that the financial impact on business is de minimis because not even one business in the state of California would opt to use OEHHA's proposed warnings. That assumption simply cannot be supported, as Andrew Chang from Andrew Chang and Company will point out after me. Therefore, if OEHHA is not going to abandon this effort and devote itself instead to the more pressing issue regarding the need to define when Proposition 65 warnings are in fact required, then at a minimum, OEHHA needs to substantially rework its draft rule and initial statement of reasons, provide a more meaningful economic impact analysis, and then recirculate them for another round of full public comment before proceeding to finalize any rule, any change to the existing regulation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll give a second try. Elizabeth Trainer, Philmar Regulatory Roundtable.
Good morning. My name is Elizabeth Trainer. I'm the director of the Philmar Regulatory Roundtable Occupational Safety and Health Forum. We work with corporations that are dedicated to improving workplace safety and health. PRR members employ more than 400,000 individuals in the U.S. and have annual revenues of $750 billion. And we have a few comments that we'd like to offer. First, the members were very supportive of OEHA's decision to permit compliance with the hazard communication and GHS as to prove compliance with Proposition 65 in the workplace. Since these warnings are already required and training is already required for employees. Also, secondly, we appreciate the elimination of the health pictogram under the GHS because those, we agree that it would not have been effective in furthering the public's understanding of the risk. Most people do not understand the globally harmonized system of classification and labeling of chemicals. They do not understand what those pictograms mean, and they would not have any idea what was trying to be conveyed to them unless they had been taught or trained on that from their employers in the workplace. So we appreciate that as well. We also support removing the proposed requirement to submit posted information information on all posted warnings to the OEHHA website. That information would have inundated the public rather than provided anything that was meaningful, and so we support that as well. We do not believe it would have added clarity. Some concerns still remain, however. We appreciate that the language "will expose" has been removed, but concern remains with the proposed language entering this area can expose you to chemicals known to the state. This implies a certainty that an exposure can and, in fact, will occur to a person whenever they enter an area that is covered by the warning. We believe that the possible, it's going to be misleading because the possible occurrence of a threshold exposure or any exposure at all may be infrequent and only under certain conditions, and people will be under the impression that they are exposed. So we believe that OEHHA, and we make recommendations for how that should be changed. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, next speaker, Andrew Chang from Andrew Chang and Company.
My name is Andrew Chang, and I'm the managing director of Andrew Chang and Company, a fiscal and economic consulting firm here in Sacramento. I've served in various positions within California state government, including economist within the governor's office, chief deputy director of Department of General Services, assistant secretary of the State and Consumer Services Agency, where my responsibilities included overseeing the agency's fiscal and economic assessments of proposed regulations. On behalf of the California Chamber of Commerce, I'm here to comment on OEHHA's fiscal and economic assessment of the proposed Proposition 65 regulations. Based on our preliminary analysis, OEHHA's economic assessment is deficient. As a whole, OEHHA fails to demonstrate that it has deliberately examined the fiscal and economic costs. Rather, OEHHA provides only a flawed assumption that there is no cost because, quote, businesses are already subject to the warning requirements of Proposition 65. The proposed regulations do not impose any mandatory requirements that would significantly increase costs for businesses. However, OEHHA's proposals will change the manner by which businesses administer and the responsibilities under Proposition 65. By design, the new regulations will cause businesses in California to behave differently, and those differences have associated costs. In the first years of implementation, the regulations will cause businesses to, one, post new signs. Two, and in regards to the website, it's going to provide to the state new information, including the, quote, concentration of the chemical or chemicals in the final product, the anticipated routes and pathways of exposures to the listed chemicals, the anticipated routes and pathways to exposure of the listed chemicals for which the warning is being provided, and any other related information that the lead agency deems necessary. In addition to that, it will increase the burden of testing products and facilities by requiring warnings to specify one or more of the 12 chemicals. In the outer years, the regulations are expected to increase litigation costs, as we've heard from so many people before me who testified today. The changes will require business to make investments that they would otherwise not have made. Our preliminary analysis indicates that the cost associated with the proposal rulemaking would cost California consumers between $500 million and $900 million in the first year of operation. Under the California Code of Regulation, a standardized regulatory impact assessment for major rule regulations must be submitted for any proposed rulemaking in which the expected impact is greater than $50 million in the first year of full enactment. There is a caveat to that particular requirement, and it's as determined, quote, by the enacting department. That last part's key is a key issue here. Our preliminary findings establish that the threshold for a major rulemaking is far exceeded by a factor of at least tenfold, even under our lowest estimate for the first year costs. We believe that if OEHHA conducted any due diligence in regards to the cost, OEHHA would quickly determine that the cost would meet the minimum requirements of a major regulation. The purpose of the Regulatory Reforms Act in 2011 with respect to economic assessments were to provide more transparency and provide for more thoughtful discussion and debate regarding both costs and benefits to California stemming from the proposed regulations. by failing to provide a thoughtful assessment of the impact of its proposed rulemaking, as it is required to do, OEHHA is cynically subverting the open process that was agreed to by the legislature and enacted into law by the governor. OEHHA should perform its required responsibilities and provide a standardized regulatory impact assessment for major regulations for its proposed rulemaking.
Thanks. Next commenter, Julia Reggie of Global Automakers.
Good morning. I'm Julia Reach with the Association of Global Automakers, Director for Environment and Energy. I'm here today on behalf of both Global Automakers and the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers. We will be submitting our comments jointly, and so we are doing our statement jointly as well. And together, our two associations represent nearly every company selling vehicles in the United States. First, we would like to thank OEHHA for its openness and willingness to work with industry partners in considering changes to the warning requirements and for the many positive changes since the previous draft. We understand that OEHHA has been tasked to improve the warning requirements, making them more useful for the consumer and ensuring that consumers have information to determine how to limit their exposure. It is important, however, that in providing clarity and consistency for the consumer, the same is also provided for businesses that must comply with these requirements. The draft regulations leave much uncertainty for businesses and do not sufficiently recognize past agreements, such as consent judgments, that were made to ensure compliance and reduce litigation. We have several concerns we'd like to raise today. OEHHA has proposed general warning requirements that could be applied to many products, as well as warning requirements specific to certain product types, businesses, and locations. Many of these specific requirements target vehicles and engines and/or locations that accommodate these products, such as parking facilities and repair facilities. Much of this focus is on exhaust emissions. It is unclear to us why the focus has been so heavily placed on these products, which are already subject to significant and stringent regulations addressing tailpipe emissions by the state of California. California has a long history of regulating vehicles and engines to reduce smog and greenhouse gases, as well as exposure to the consumer. Most recently, the California Air Resources Board finalized standards in 2012 that reduced the emissions from passenger cars, light-duty trucks, and medium-duty vehicles to near-zero levels, with implementation already underway. Therefore, we believe that OEHHA should reconsider the necessity of providing specific labels for vehicles and engines related to exhaust emissions and instead maintain focus on areas or locations where exposure may occur, such as parking facilities where idling may occur. Furthermore, the section for passenger vehicle and regulations should be amended to make it clear that passenger vehicles include, in addition to passenger cars and light-duty trucks, medium-duty vehicles, and even heavy-duty vehicles. This change would provide better consistency for product types, which all have similar content that would require warning requirements under Prop 65, and should otherwise be treated the same by these warning requirements. While we understand that OEHA's proposed regulations are intended to provide greater clarity and relevance to consumers, any new warning requirements must be carefully designed to ensure that the agreements made in previous consent judgments can be met without resulting in unnecessary duplication of requirements. The December 15, 1999 consent judgment with Mateel designates specific language as well as specific locations where that language must be provided. OEHA's initial statement of reason notes that regardless of the regulation, the terms of any court-approved settlement must be met. While the intent of the language proposed in these regulations for vehicles may be in the spirit of the consent judgment, the language does not match the court-approved language and therefore would result in application of multiple warnings in the owner's manual to ensure both OEHA's regulations and the judgment are met. We urge OEHA to revise the regulations to grandfather in these settlements, and more specifically, to revise the owner's manual warning requirement to match some of the language from that settlement. We will provide specific language in our written comments to help address this language under consent of judgment and for the owner's manuals. And then there would still be the additional point of sale warning provided that it could provide the new language that OEHA intends. Finally, there are several areas in the proposed regulations that would benefit from further clarity and description. In some cases, the ISOR provides some guidance on how these regulations should be interpreted, but it's necessary to provide that clarity in the actual regulations as well.
For instance, where OEHHA has provided specific warning requirements for some products, and these warning labels have specialized language and labeling types, the regulations need to clarify that application of the specific warning requirement label is deemed in compliance with the regulations overall, and that the general warning would no longer be necessary in these situations. That is not clear in the regulatory text. In other words, by applying the specific warning requirement for a product, the general warning requirement is not necessary. Thus, we request additional clarity and certainty of this intent, and that it be included in the regulations to make the compliance requirements clearer. We also have a number of other requests that we will be addressing in our written comments. To give you just an idea of a few of these, we do support the provision that allows 2 years lead time prior to implementation of the regulations. However, in the interim, we believe it is necessary for some clarification regarding the current regulations and how they would be used, since by repealing the current regulations, there would essentially be nothing on the books in that 2 year time period. We also support the idea of a sell-through period and making it clear that products that were manufactured prior to the implementation date that may have long shelf lives could maintain the what would be current today's current warning requirements. We would like to have additional clarity regarding the formatting and application of the warning requirements for passenger vehicles. We believe it would be helpful to provide CAS numbers in conjunction with the 12 listed chemicals to make clear exactly which of those chemicals and their compounds would be impacted with the warning requirements. We have supported in our previous comments and continues to support the use of the term may expose rather than can expose, which we believe better reflects the realities of risk and potential for exposure. And finally, we believe it would be helpful to provide a de minimis level for all chemicals so that trace amounts of these chemicals would not require a label, and it would be clear that a label is not required. Thank you for considering our comments. As I noted, we'll be submitting joint written comments with global automakers and the Alliance, and then later we'll provide testimony on the website. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next speaker is David Rowe.
Thank you. I'm David Rowe. I'm not speaking on behalf of any organization today. I hope I'm speaking on behalf of the voters who voted for this proposition many years ago. Three general comments and a few specifics. The two most important words in this proposal are can and expose. We seem to have gotten past at least the first few flurries of objection to that. Expose, obviously, is exactly what the statute calls for. It calls for warning when somebody's exposed. So including the word exposed seems to be not only a perfect fit, but hard to imagine not. The word can, however, and I'd like to support the earlier comments, is still unnecessarily ambiguous. This is a safe harbor warning. The statute requires warnings only for knowing and intentional exposures, and there is no reason to create ambiguity from the point of view of the business that knows and intends it's exposing people. The argument, well, we just don't know, is a perfectly understandable argument. If I were a businessman, I'd make the same argument, but this statute says, fine, you find out. That's your job. And if in the meantime you want to warn more people than you really think you need to, go ahead. But actually warn them. Will expose actually is a warning about exposure. Can, maybe, maybe not. That's not what the statute calls for. This is an old horse. I hope not a dead horse, but I think it's important to point out and very important to emphasize this is a safe harbor. Businesses can design their own warnings based on their own opinions and research on what is and isn't happening at will. This also goes to the purpose of improving warnings, which is the clearer the warning, the more focused the warning, the more pointed the warning, the fewer warnings there will be. Because the clearer the warning, the more likely it is that the business will in fact do what it needs to do not to have to warn. And by that, I don't mean talking to its lawyers. I mean changing its exposures so that they are below any warnable level. That's why you're going to this trouble, is not to increase the number of warnings, but to decrease the number of warnings by making them clearer, sharper, and more pointed. One thing I noticed when Carol put up the slide of the old and new safe harbor proposed warnings was the new one is longer than the old one. By definition, that's a mistake. Anything longer isn't as clear, even if it's written in nice, short English words. It's longer, it's clunkier, it's more distracting, it has less impact on the reader just by virtue of length. The symbol is great. Beyond the symbol, all the extraneous words tend to diminish somebody's likelihood of actually reading the whole thing. And I have some suggestions later on about how to do something about that. My third general point is that all of the content of the regulations seems to be constructive in good faith and fairly clear as to what it's trying to do, but the execution is still erratic. There are still lots of ways in which this is written in loose language that creates or potential for loopholes, inconsistencies. And as you've already heard, these are regulations that at least some lawyers will be looking to try to challenge. The more opportunity you give for that with loose threads, internal inconsistencies, the more trouble that there's going to be. So I would just urge a much more legalistic, tight connecting up the dots. Simple examples, environmental exposures, defining where you should give warnings in an affected area at all public entrances. Well, what if the affected area is 20 square blocks of Sacramento? Where are the public entrances to that? Clearly somebody wanted to do something, but it wasn't thought through. Newspaper warnings. In the situations where you give newspaper warnings, doesn't specify what kind of newspaper, much less one that's actually circulated locally. You could put something in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch and comply with these regs as written. Not with the way they're meant to be written, not with the way they were intended to be written, but the way they are written. So I don't want to go on, and I will submit detailed written comments, but this needs attention. This sort of making sure it's tight needs attention. Specifically, a few points. The anti-dilution section is a very positive addition to the regulations. Its drafting is still ambiguous because that is certainly something that will be litigated. So I will have specific suggestions on tightening that up, but it's a very good idea. Don't put anything in a warning that dilutes the warning. On product exposures, and I know there's been a lot of back and forth about definitions here, I think there is an internal confusion about what's a product. I think what's meant, reading it, is a consumer product where the exposure is to the consumer who gets it. But it's not written that way. It's written so that a nuclear power plant purchased by PG&E could be a product. Obviously, that's not what meant. That's the way it's written. Or an HVAC system for a building purchased by a building owner with a warning on the invoice. I'm giving you this because it's important, and I think the fundamental clarification is consumer product where the exposure that this section applies to is the exposure to the consumer who gets the product at the end of the line. And I think that would clear up a lot of what are otherwise problematic wrinkles in the language as it sits. The retailer chain of responsibility, this is trying to do what the statute says, which is to take the burden off the retailer and put it in a more in the hands of somebody with better control over doing something about the exposure. Unfortunately, drafting there creates a lot of opportunities for loopholes and cutouts. And by a cutout, I mean here, we'll hand the legal responsibility to this tiny little judgment-proof entity that exists only to hold that liability. This is a very old issue, and again, clear language can solve it. On the One suggestion that was made in the last round about trying to give people access to more information quickly and electronically was QR codes, the little funny-looking square box that you scan. And I'd like to urge you to reconsider that, because unlike a URL, nobody's going to stop and, even if they've got a cell phone connected to the internet, stop and type in a long URL and then read. But they can scan something. So a URL as part of a safe harbor warning is really added verbiage that dilutes the shortness and clarity of it. But a QR code would not be. Yes, not everybody carries around in their pocket the ability to scan a QR code, but you're talking to the people who do, because you're talking about going on the internet in the first place. This would get somebody on fast if they were really curious. So I ask you to revive consideration of that, consistent with making these warnings short, clear, focused, and actually accessible to people, rather than long, clunky, and discouraging to read.
Sorry, David, are you getting close?
Yes,
to the end? You're
very much.
A little over 5 minutes. Okay.
Thanks. Okay. And of course, there are many other details which I will not go into, because you're taking written comments, and some of this is appropriate for written comments. One specific that I do think needs special attention is the amusement park warning, which seems to be particularly early in its evolution of careful drafting. For example, what it applies to is not even defined. The headline says, the caption says amusement park, but the actual draft regulation, I'm sure, Gene, this isn't your fault, doesn't even say amusement park. It literally says facility, and those of you who are lawyers know that you're not allowed to read the caption as part of the meaning of regulatory text. With that, I'll stop. I think this is a very positive direction, and I just think the ship needs to be tightened up. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, Mike, is it Pierce Pence from WS Dodge Oil?
Good morning. My name is Mike Pierce with the WS Dodge Oil Company. We're a small, independent, family-owned company in the Los Angeles area. We provide metalworking lubricants to all the manufacturers and generally in Southern California and the Western United States. We're the largest manufacturer of these things west of the Rockies. We provide about half of all these lubricants. I also am a member of ILMA, Independent Lubricant Manufacturers Association, who will be providing separate written comments at a later date. Chances are, if you used a machine or a device of some kind that requires lubrication, that lubrication came from an ILMA member. So, you know, you don't see us, you don't know about us, but we're there. Specifically, I'd like to address the issue of cost. As a small businessman, that there's no cost associated with this is laughable. No offense to anyone, but for example, we're currently in the process of trying to comply with GHS. And for those of you who are not familiar with what's going on, the Globally Harmonized System of Labeling and Classification, we're having to redo all of our safety data sheets, all of our product labels. This, to my specific industry, specific SIC code 2992, is approximately $150,000 to $200,000 per company. These labels are currently being designed and promulgated. If we have to add Prop 65 warnings on there, you add a color. Some manufacturers may not have bought the color printer required for that. If we have to add separate language, council advises, we can't just put a warning on there for Prop 65 in Spanish. The entire OSHA required warning should be in Spanish as well. A label that is this size, maybe 4x6, 6x8, something like that, just doubled or tripled in size. And that's a significant cost. Also, in terms of the cost of litigation, we're a small company. We don't have in-house industrial hygienists. We don't have in-house counsel. We have to take the most conservative approach possible to protect ourselves. And having been a victim of these kinds of lawsuits, we have no other recourse except to warn and label as best possible we can to everything there. What that means, though, previous speaker talked about pulling these chemicals out. You know, businesses want to remove them. That's very difficult to do. Many of our products are approved under a PPAP process, which is a way of manufacturers ensuring that a part will be made properly. The lubricant is specified. To design a new lubricant not using these chemicals might take a year to 18 months just by itself. The PPAP process can take 12 to 18 months just by itself. And there's no guarantee at the end of all this that the new product works. So there are very significant costs associated with this. Also, I would just like to say, as you know, a member of ILMA, products that might be imported into the state by a manufacturer here, say they have a plant in Illinois, and they bring in a drum of a chemical to California. Well, in Illinois, it won't have the Prop 65 warning. It gets here now, someone spots that. What happens to that manufacturer who brought it in? Who's responsible? I'd also like, just for the record, we're not sure what the definition of area is, in that a small manufacturing shop, no problem. I have a customer with a 250,000 square foot facility. Most of the employees there would never be exposed to any of these chemicals. It's used, the formaldehyde in particular is used in one small area. Do we warn everybody going into that facility, even though they're in a totally separate areas, never ever step foot there? It's very unclear to us. Formaldehyde in particular is another cost. Our industry uses what are called formaldehyde condensate, or biocides, things that, when they react with the bacterium, create formaldehyde at the point of contact. The formaldehyde then kills the bacterium and self-destructs in the process. We do not intentionally add formaldehyde per se. Nevertheless, the cost of trying to figure out if we meet the safe harbor requirements for formaldehyde contained in the regulations, by several estimates that we've received, it run between $50,000 and $100,000. That's a great cost. And if we choose to remove these biocides, now I go through the same product reformulation process, which costs thousands and thousands of dollars. So no, we believe there are very significant costs associated with this, and we would appreciate feedback on that. Finally, on petroleum products and the specific area warnings, we're not sure which one we would qualify under. The general warning for a specific area, the petroleum products, because it talks about crude oil, benzene, toluene, diesel fuel, things that are not in a modern industrial manufacturing environment. We're talking about highly refined products. So we're not clear at all what would apply and how would it be applied. And if we're not clear, there's some lawyer who's going to make it clear to us. So anyway, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Next speaker, Kevin Messner of Political Logic for the Association of Home Appliance Manufacturers.
Hi, thank you. Kevin Messner. On behalf of the Association of Home Appliance Manufacturers, I just wanted to start out with some positives, which are OEHHA has done a great job, I think, in listening and meeting and trying to hear our concerns. And so that has been welcomed, and thank you for that. With that said, we're still in a very problematic state, I think, of the way the current regulations are. I'll just touch on a few areas and then submit some written comments. Going back to the governor's requirements to help the consumer, to reduce litigation, and to deal with overwarning, we don't feel this proposal hits on any of those areas. And just briefly, the over-labeling is going to be increased from this regulation. You've heard already, and I won't go through it as much, but the Supreme Court has already California Supreme Court actually has recognized the consumer fatigue that comes in with over-labeling and over-warning, I guess I should say. And adding a bigger label with 12 chemicals is just going to continue to have consumers that are going to either look at the label and be scared, where there may not be, with no prioritizing of what to be scared over, or they'll disregard it because they're just the fatigue of the warning. And so it's not going to have the impact that it really needs to have. The increased litigation is going to come, and afternoon I'll talk more on the website, but not only do the 12 chemicals increase the litigation and the opportunity for a creative lawyer to find a way to sue somebody, and is going to just increase that, the 12 chemicals. And so you're going to, if you want to be safe and you're a manufacturer, you just put all 12 chemicals on the label just to be sure that you don't get sued and even just have to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars just to reach some type of settlement. The website, and it's great that it's been changed over so it's not directly impacted by a private enforcement action, but it still has litigation risk and will still have potential to increase litigation. If a manufacturer does not supply the requested information or doesn't have it and cannot supply it, which is allowable under the way the regulations are drafted, which is fine, that can still be used indirectly in other litigation in other areas through discovery and other types of thing. And also, AHAM manufacturers and members are very conscious and want to comply and comply with government agency requests. And so when they get this request and don't have the information, and it's just going to, it has a lot of things that are problematic. And so I just want to emphasize that the litigation risk of the website has not been removed. The last thing I wanted to touch on was certainty for business, which is the third prong of the governor's statement. And this proposal does nothing to increase the certainty for business. In fact, it increases the uncertainty for manufacturers. Rather have the current status quo than to go where we are now, because with 12 chemicals, the website, all the different things that are out there, manufacturers then are asking me, what would we do here? What would we do here? How would we deal with this? What would be the unknowns are very problematic. I'm sorry, actually, then the very last thing is, and very important, is the owner's manual. The current regulation does not allow the warning to be placed in the owner's manual. That is a huge, huge problem. That's a massive departure from where we are today. And there are a number of warnings and information in owner's manual that consumers know to go to and know to look for. And you'd be missing not only a great opportunity for the consumer to go to where they generally know that these warnings exist and make that not possible. So we will supply information or an amendment to it. You only need to add one word or two words to the regulation to ensure that the owner's manuals can be used as a place to provide warning to the consumers. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, Lowell Chow from the Environmental Law Foundation.
All right. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'm Lowell Chow from the Environmental Law Foundation. First off, I want to extend some apologies on behalf of Jim Wheaton, our founder and senior counsel, who is under the weather and couldn't be here today, so you're going to get me instead. Now, I want to begin by noting that we earlier had expressed our support last summer during the pre-regulatory proceedings here for taking these steps in the first place. And so we are very glad to see that the regulations continue to be on a good track, especially since I want to point out that this is basically the first substantial revision to these regulations in a couple decades. I want to emphasize that one of the primary purposes of Proposition 65 is to encourage informed consumer behavior. And so to that end, we want to reiterate what we think good Prop 65 regulations should all hope to achieve. First, regulations should be consistent with the best science available and be accommodating of that. Second, very common theme today is that these regulations should hope to provide good guidance for business. But in our view, probably most importantly, these regulations need to encourage consumer behavior that is informed and real. And so we simply want to say that these proposed regulations, in our view, are continuing to take steps toward, first, increasing clarity, second, avoiding ambiguity, and third, make the warnings more useful for the consumer. The common theme here is that there should be more info, not less. We acknowledge that the current draft is not perfect, but we are confident in the process going forward. You can expect some comments from us on specific details. But what I want to conclude with is that we hope that as OEHHA gets closer to issuing final regulations, that it will continue to keep, again, the primary purpose of Prop 65, informed consumer choice, in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, Tim Shestek, American Chemistry Council.
Thank you, Alan. Good morning. Tim Shestek with the American Chemistry Council. We too will be providing some more detailed comments before the deadline. Certainly agree with OEHHA and others that abusive and wasteful litigation should be stemmed, but I wanted to focus just briefly today on one provision that's being proposed, and that's the proposed label requirements listing the 12 listed chemicals. We continue to believe, as we mentioned at the end of last year, that the statute does not provide any authority to support a secondary listing of specific chemicals. Once a chemical has been listed on Prop 65, there is simply no mechanism to further designate a subset of chemicals for further evaluation or designation. Chemicals get added to the list without regard to anything that can be used to rank them for hazard, potency, number of people exposed, human health risk. The statute simply does not set up to do this kind of ranking or prioritization. Furthermore, we believe this special warning requirement or option also adds to this perceived overwarning problem and the fact that it creates the potential for consumers to disregard all warnings except those mentioning a chemical by name. The so-called list of 12 proposal will likely be interpreted as the state signaling that certain chemicals and the products therein as being more dangerous. We continue to believe that this provision has the potential to be a source of lawsuit abuse that is contrary to the governor's objective. In fact, businesses could be sued if they did not include one or more listed chemicals on a label, even if only minuscule amounts of any of the 12 were present. For these reasons, we believe that this particular provision should be deleted from the proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, Gene Livingston, representing Kappa.
I'm Gene Livingston with the law firm of Greenberg Troy here on behalf of the California Traction and Parks Association. We appreciate you having worked with us in developing the specific warning mechanism for amusement parks, and we'll be acknowledging that in our written comments. This morning, I wanted to focus on the symbol. You've heard a number of people comment on that earlier today. In my mind, there's a question whether you even need the symbol. You start out and the current warning says warning. And most people, regardless of the language that they speak, will recognize that word, warning, danger, and so on, much sooner than they'll recognize a triangle with an exclamation point in it for its significance. So there's a question in my mind about whether there's even a need for that symbol. But if there is, shouldn't it be something that's more tailored to what we're talking about, Proposition 65, instead of this general concept? And I noticed that in the warning itself, you say, for more information, go to www.P65warnings. And if you use the same language in your website in the warning, then you tie the two together. So in my mind, it makes a lot more sense to link those two, the warning that they're seeing now with the website. The third point that I want to make with respect to the symbol is this use of the yellow background. And you've heard a number of people talk about the problems with the printing on that. And, you know, I don't know what's magical about yellow. What is important, if you're going to use that triangle with the exclamation point, is that that exclamation point be visible. And you achieve the same thing if you just simply provide the exclamation point in a contrasting background. The color becomes much less important in order to communicate what you're about. Having offered that third option, I'm not asking you not to consider the first two, whether it's even needed, and secondly, isn't something like P65 more significant? Thank you.
Thank you. The last individual who has given us a card asking to speak is Kevin Washington with Illinois Tool Works, Inc.
I hope I can live up to the hype of being the last to close us out. I thank you for the opportunity to speak and address your proposed rule. I am Kevin Washington with ITW. We're a global manufacturer of mostly commercial and industrial goods that have commercial and industrial applications. As a product manufacturer through a multitude of markets, we have the opportunity to interact with a number of different government officials and agencies, and I want to thank OEHHA for its openness and willingness to engage us and be accessible to clearly work on a rule about which you care, but also try to be responsive to the needs of stakeholders, notwithstanding the appreciation we have for your mission and the objectives you're trying to accomplish. I'm also glad to hear, if I understood correctly, that there will still be opportunities to engage with stakeholders individually and then even corporately in additional changes, perhaps another iteration and round of public interaction. I want to associate myself with a number of the concerns in the interest of time that you've heard earlier today with regard to cost and other coordination concerns that still exist for product manufacturers. From my perspective and ITW's perspective, a lot of our concern as a multinational company for many of the businesses that make products for multiple markets, largely certainly in the United States or to the extent that we even export, the point is, that we manufacture products for a variety of markets, and complying with any one individual market can create complications for us that would otherwise be seen as unforeseen consequences for otherwise good policy. I take as a quick example the color aspect to the pictogram and the triangle that the rule proposes. One business alone with north of 1,500 individual products that would be impacted by this rule will be facing a potential cost in the hundreds per product represented by individual SKU numbers or SKUs. If ITW or a company like ours and businesses like ours can have that measure of financial and economic impact occur to us, the potential sales and other implications that could come from that, then, and those can be of concern to us, then it clearly can demonstrate that there are some broader market and manufacturer concerns that we will appreciate OEHHA continuing to work on and be mindful of in trying to exact good policy that's workable for all sides. So, again, with that, I look forward to continuing to work with the agency. We'll certainly also have some written comments that we'll be submitting in time for today's deadline, and thank you again for this opportunity.
Thank you very much. So that is, we've gotten to the end of people who have given us speaker cards. As I said at the beginning, it's not required for you to fill out a speaker card, so anyone who would like to speak who hasn't spoken yet, this is your chance. Raise your hand or come up to the podium. Okay. Well, Seeing none then, I hereby close this this public hearing. As a reminder, we will be accepting written public comments until 5 p.m. on April 8th, 2015. Easiest way to submit comments is via email, and you can email those to p65public.comments@oehha.ca.gov, or you can submit them via snail mail to the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, 1001 I Street, 19th floor, mail stop 19B, Sacramento, California, 95814. And as a reminder, we will hold our second hearing of the day here in this room at 1:30, and that will be on our companion website regulation. So thank you very much.